Men and women all over the globe are joining now for the best videos on the internet.
I'm doing my part.
I'm doing my part.
I'm doing my part.
And I'm doing my part too.
They're doing their part. Are you? Click the subscribe button now to become a member of the Action Pack. Would you like to know more?
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Whew, it has been a long, long year. With me getting out of the Army and starting to do full-time YouTube and starting my own business and doing all kinds of different things, plus in the box office, it was kind of a year of reckoning for a lot of things that have been going on in recent years. And, man, just the video game industry is in a weird place, and we are going to get into some of that stuff. Yes. We've got a lot to cover, so let's get straight to it and start this video. I'm Mike, and this is Mike's After Action Reviews, and this is the January Action Update, which, by the way, guys, I know it's coming out a month late. I've been very busy. We'll get into it. This is the January Action, January 2024 Action Update. The Action Pack needs you. You can support Mike's After Action Reviews on our Patreon for as little as $3 a month. Every quarter, once we've made at least $200, we're going to be giving away 10% of our earnings from Patreon in a giveaway over on our Twitch, so go check that out as well. You can find all of the links for everything in the description and in the pinned comment down below. Do your part. Support the pack. The Action Pack. All right, everybody. So starting off, as always, we are going to go over some things that have happened in the recent past. And being that this is January, we're actually going to go over a lot of things from earlier on this year as well to give you guys, get you guys all caught up on what is happening. So first off, I want to say thank you to everyone who did the Mars Summit and all of our guests over the last year and the last quarter. I know I need a haircut, but at least I shaved, so watch my hair. Anyway, so the Mars Summit is our big live stream event here at Mike's After Action Reviews, where I bring on guests who've been on the channel, and we just talk about the year in movies and video games and media. So this year we had Other Mike. I have to write them down or I forget people. So I have Other Mike, Lloyd A. Green, Tommy Boy, Amber, my sister, Salty Skipper, Travis from Oscar Mike Radio, and Staff Sergeant Matt. So just highlighting, guys, go check out Tales of Nihilism, which is where Salty Skipper, he's got a comic book that he's creating. It's on Global Comics. It's released right now. You can even get it in color. So it was in black and white only, now it's in color. Travis from Oscar Mike Radio. Oscar Mike Radio is a veteran-owned, operated podcast, and actually the podcast itself is about military soldiers and veterans. And then Lloyd A. Green is actually a YouTuber who's bigger than me, and he does great work in movie reviews. So go check him out. All great guys. He's also an author, so you can go read some of his books. I've interviewed him about some of his books, and we're going to talk about that. So thank you to those guys. And then also, earlier this year, I want to thank my guests. So this is for earlier this year, all of the reviews that we've done this year. I want to thank Mr. Brownie God, Lore Master Brian, Shakima, everyone else I've mentioned in the Mars Summit. I want to thank all of the guests from earlier this year. So all of our guests, I really appreciate it. It's really great to have a community that we here at Mike's After Action Reviews can rely on to be able to collaborate and make videos together and just have a good time. Have a good time. If you're not having fun, what's the point? So, I love my awesome Support the Troops Stormtrooper mug. Do you know where you can get a mug just like this one, but different? Bottega Crua. Bottega Crua is an Italian born and raised artisan trained at the Academy of Fine Arts in Venice, Italy. Since 2010, Bottega Crua has offered unique handmade and hand-painted ceramics, pottery, and other artistic products. You can find these products at her Etsy store by following the link down below. She also takes custom orders, but they may take longer to ship because she has to make them after you order them. So, go check out Bottega Crua to get yourself an awesome mug just like this one or the ones you've been seeing behind me as this ad has been going on. Remember, guys, supporting our partners is supporting the pack. The Action Pack. In case you missed it, so we're going to go over all of the reviews for 2023. Just list them off so that way you guys know what we've been doing. And if you missed it, you can go check it out. So earlier this year, our first review for the year was A Plague Tale Requiem. We did a rapid action review for that. We had Sandman. We did an after action review, an after action interview. So that was interesting because, so basically Salty Skipper was our guest for that, and he watched it, and I asked him about it. Because of the op tempo and certain things going on, which I've kind of gone through in other action updates throughout the year, I don't always get to do everything I want to do, but being able to talk to other creators and other guests and stuff about their experiences with some titles is a great help. So we did an after action interview for that with Salty Skipper. It's really good. Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania, we did an after action review with Other Mike. Go check it out. Other Mike is MODOK, which is awesome. We did the Gotham Knights after action interview with Mr. Brownie God. That was another one I didn't have time to play, but Mr. Brownie God did, so we were able to do that. We have the God of War Ragnarok after action interview, which I actually almost beat God of War at the time of doing the interview, but I really needed to move forward because it was around Christmas time and a lot of moving parts this year with me transitioning out of the military and all of that. But we did that with Lore Master Brian, and that was a great time. He has some great insights. It was a good time. We also did a review for Reflections of L in Search of Self. I did an interview. Now, I read the book, but I did an interview with the author of the book, Lloyd A. Green, from Endless Perceptions of Lloyd A. Green. So go check out that YouTube channel. They're really great. Forspoken After Action Review. We did that. I did that one by myself. So the video game ones I tend to do by myself, unless I haven't played it and I'm going to do an interview. Hogwarts Legacy, we did the After Action review for that. The Super Mario Bros. Movie After Action Review with Shakima, the most popular video for the longest time. It has now been overtaken by the trailer reaction for Society of the Snow. Tales of Nihilism After Action Interview, where we talk with Salty Skipper about the comic book that he is creating. By the way, Salty Skipper is a veteran, so if you want to support a veteran, go check out his comic book. The Flash Rapid Action Review. Actually, I was going to do a full-length review, and I wasn't able to. And so I did a rapid action review with the plan of following that up with the full length review, and I just was never able to get it done. I apologize for that. If you guys really want to see that, let me know in the comment section down below, and if we're able to, if there's big enough interest, I will go back and do the review, but it's looking like that is a way. Anytime that I miss something or, if it's going to be popular with you guys and you let me know in the comments, I will do things that I planned not doing. Based on you guys' feedback. So, and then also Star Wars Jedi Survivor After Action Review. We did that and it was, I really liked that game. Go check out the review. I don't think it was as good as the first one, but it was good. So, reviews later just in the last 3 months that we did, Aliens Dark Descent After Action Review. That was probably my favorite game of the year just because, other than God of War, I named this as my game of the year because during the Mars Summit, because somebody else had said God of War, and God of War was a, like God of War Ragnarok was a, it was one of those things where it's like, that was kind of the obvious one that we did this year. And I just, I wanted, somebody else had already taken it. So I wanted to take something different. And I would say God of War Ragnarok, probably the best game that I played this year and beat this year and did the review of, but then also Aliens Dark Descent After Ash review. Aliens Dark Descent was so good. That's a great game. Go check out the review and go check out the game. We did the Starfield Rapid Action Review, Marvel's Spider-Man 2 After Action Review, the Marvel's After Action Review. I did that with Other Mike, so thank Other Mike. Thank you, Other Mike, for that. The Lord of the Rings Return to Moria Rapid Action Review. That was a good game. Go check out my review. Go check out the game. It's really good. We did the Napoleon After Action Review with Tommy Wine. Now, Tommy Wine and I both said that we actually liked this movie. I think that maybe going back and watching the review, and I kind of realize that I probably needed to articulate a little bit better that we both understood that Napoleon in this movie was weird and not historically accurate exactly. And it was goofy and it wasn't what people wanted, and that's why the movie didn't do so well. But at the same time, it was so weird. It was funny, like almost like an unintentional comedy. I have no idea why Ridley Scott made this movie this way. But that's why we enjoyed it, because we went in and we were like, this is crazy. This is one of those movies where you kind of like get drunk and watch. I don't drink or smoke or do any of that stuff. But this is one of those movies that I imagine people would have a fun time getting drunk and watching. Anyway, okay, so then Rebel Moon Part 1, A Child of Fire After Action Review. I did that with Travis from Oscar Mike Radio. And look, the movie's getting kind of torn apart by critics and stuff. But actually, we both liked it. I mean, it wasn't something amazing, but it was okay for us. We also did a product review this year, the Levine Wood Marble Cutting Board After Action Review. We did that with my wife, Ellie. And we had a good time, and the cutting board is very great. Very great. The cutting board is great, so go check it out if you haven't seen it. It's a good price, so if you're in the market for a cutting board and you want something a little higher end, get that one. RoboCop Rogue City, a game that just, it's better than it should have been. I was so surprised at how good this game actually was. We did, the RoboCop Rogue City Rapid Action Review. Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom After Action Review. I think that movie was good. I know that there's the thing about, oh, the guy eating a cockroach, whatever. I don't care about that. I care about the movie and the substance of it and what it was and the performances on screen. And I liked all of that. And I did that review with Other Mike, so thank you for that. So, what is going on in the channel other than just those releases? So, for one thing is that so Mike's After Action Reviews as a YouTube channel has grown. We've hit 1,000 subscribers, for one thing, which we'll be talking about that in a minute. But we also reached monetization on YouTube as far as tier one. So there are two tiers of monetization. We have hit the first tier, which allows us to put the shop up underneath the video, so you'll see all of our merch underneath this video, and go check that out. And it also allows me to offer memberships to people, so if you get a membership, you will get videos the night before they are released to the general public, so you can be a little high class here at Mars. So you can purchase merchandise on YouTube. Below the video description, above the comment section, you'll see our merch. We really, really appreciate the support, guys. If you guys check it out, I mean, you guys can get an awesome... See, I have my microphone, but if I stand up, you guys can see it. You can get this awesome werewolf shirt. And it's got the Mars on the back, and it looks cool, and it says Alpha on there. It's really good. I think that I'm very happy with the way that these turned out. My dad and my stepmother made the... If I could get this, made the logo for this, so that's cool. and then, like I said, becoming a member, you get supers and mentions and emojis and stuff like that, that you can put in the comment section, and, Yeah, and you get early video, and also your name will be in the credits of the video. So, like, at the end of this video, you're going to see the credits roll. Those are all of our sponsors, our financial partners, and the people that, like, my financial partners that, you know, some of them you see on the channel, some of them you don't, but they are in the credits, and you can be too. Okay, so, moving forward here. Let's see. So we have that. All right. So again, like I said, in case you missed it, we have the 2023 releases that happened in the last quarter. Let's go over some things. I told you it was kind of a box office reckoning this year for movies and video games. And that really has proven to be true. The longer the year went on, the more and more I saw, like, wow, this really is not the greatest year for stuff. So let's check it out. In October, if we go back, so like I said, guys, I know that this is coming out a little late, but if we start at January, go back 3 months to last quarter. So we have October. We had, and then the last action update, I talked about how I was going to do, 3 movies and video games. It's too much. I'm going to do 2. So 2 movies and video games, except for in October, because there was one. I made an exception for October because there was one extra I wanted to add, but let's check it out. So we had Assassin's Creed Mirage. It was released on the PlayStation 5, PlayStation 4, Xbox One, Xbox Series X and Series S, iOS, Microsoft Windows, and Amazon Luna. It was released on October 5th, 2023. It was developed by Ubisoft Bordeaux and published by Ubisoft. Its review scores from IGN was 8 out of 10, PC Gamer 77%. And GameSpot was 6 out of 10. The consensus that I found is that it isn't above... So, by the way, I talk about this every time because I always feel... Every time as I'm saying the consensus, I feel that possibly people won't exactly understand what it means. Like, I write this. This is not something that other people write. I actually write the consensus for myself. But I just read it because... I want to make sure that I get all of my thoughts here. So it's an above average game, but it's not excellent. And it is a sort of return to form for the series with a focus on great stealth and having a shorter runtime to cut down on bloat that we've seen in recent games in the franchise. It does suffer from possibly oversimplistic plot and bland characters. The gameplay is good, and the story does not drag itself out, which is much appreciated because, you know, every video game is going to have people that like it and want more, but every game is also going to have people that maybe not even don't like it, but just, you know, it's not the greatest thing to them, and so having a 40-hour runtime can drag that on instead of having a 8 to 10, maybe even 12, 15-hour runtime, so... okay, so on the game's profitability, from PushSquare.com on October 11th, 2023, we're roughly 1 week removed from the release of Assassin's Creed Mirage, and Ubisoft has taken to social media in order to boast of the game's success. However, the publisher statement is rather vague. It doesn't disclose any concrete sales numbers, a growing trend amongst just about every company, and instead focuses on the broader picture. With the numbers of players being in line with... This is from Ubisoft now. With the number of players being in line with past successful launches such as Assassin's Creed Origins and Assassin's Creed Odyssey, we are humbled by the positive reception, says Ubisoft. It goes on to claim that Bossum's Adventure has been the publisher's best-selling title on current-gen consoles. Like the PS5, Mirage is the biggest new-gen launch in terms of units sales to date at Ubisoft. Okay, awesome. So that's pretty cool. Great for them, Assassin's Creed Mirage. Not an amazing game, but quite successful financially. And I've heard some people say that it actually is a fun title. So if you're looking for the next thing in Assassin's Creed, go check that one out. Then we had Gangs of Sherwood, which was supposed to be released on October 19th to the PlayStation 5, Microsoft Windows, Xbox Series X and S, But it was delayed to November 27th, so we'll go over that one in just a second. November 27th, 2023. Okay, so then we have Alan Wake 2, which released on the PlayStation 5, Xbox Series X and Series S, and Microsoft Windows. It was released on October 27th, 2023, and it was developed by Remedy Entertainment and published by Epic Games Publishing. The review scores from IGN were 9 out of 10, PC Gamer 88%, and Eurogamer.net 3 out of 5. The consensus that I found amongst the reviews is that the game is a great story set in an interesting world backed by a high production value and drenched in surrealism. The weakness of this twisted tale is that players may not always be able to understand exactly what everything means or what is happening. Some have even gone as far as to say that the creator, Sam Lake, overindulged himself in trying to make the experience deep while actually only giving the illusion of depth. Now, I will say this about this in my consensus is that critics oftentimes will come out and have an art piece like either a movie or video game, and they will praise it because it's so artful and amazing, and oh, all these different, you know, surreal ideas that are presented and all this. But actually, then audiences get it, and they're like, this doesn't make any sense. David Lynch comes to mind. You can think that it's deep, but it doesn't mean anything to me, so I don't care about it. Basically, that's the idea. And I think that, yeah, it seems to... So I didn't play this game, but it seems to me that that's a possibility of what happened here based on what I'm seeing from reviews and, user reviews and stuff like that. Okay, but anyway, on to the game's profitability. The game... From GameWorldObserver.com on December 12th, 2023, Alan Wake 2, with an estimated production budget of $50 million, is now the most expensive released title in Remedy's catalog. In its latest financial report, the company noted that the game has a strong basis for good long-term sales. It is worth noting that Alan Wake 2 was fully funded by Epic Games. Remedy will be entitled to 50% of its net revenue after the Fortnite maker fully recoups development and marketing expenses, so it is interesting to see how the game performs in the long run. I remember Control was a game that didn't get a whole lot of hype and stuff like that. As for like marketing hype, you know, and then after it came out, I found out about it and I was like, whoa, like I played it and I did a retro action review of it. It was a really good game. So from IGN though, on December 14th, 2023, in Alan Wake 2's case, there was no physical release and its publisher Epic Games does not provide digital sales data on Circana. Data to Circana, so there's just no way for Circana to tell us how well it sold. We can supplement that with a bit more data from Ampere's analysis, Piers Harding Rolls, though, to get a clearer picture. Ampere estimates that globally, just on console, Alan Wake 2 sold 850,000 copies as of the end of November. Okay, so Alan Wake, and then this is from Fan Nation on December 13th, 2023. Alan Wake 2 is definitely a critical hit, but there are doubts about its commercial success. Mind you, that doesn't automatically mean that the game has been a financial flop for Remedy. Sometimes games don't sell in numbers the public would find impressive while exceeding what the developer itself had expected. So if they, basically what that's saying is, if they expected to maybe lose some money or not sell so well, that's fine. At least in the short term, because they probably feel like they're going to make up for it in later sales of the game. But I will tell you that 850 copies sold is not an impressive number. I've just started doing this where I'm looking more into this portion of video games, like financially, what is successful and what's not. And you need a couple million for a game that costs as much, like 50 million. Plus the fact that Remedy's only going to get 50% of the net profit. So... that's minus expenses, man. Anyway, all right, so moving on. Marvel Spider-Man 2 released on the PlayStation 5. It was released on the October 20th, 2023. It was developed by Insomniac Games and published by Sony Interactive Entertainment. The review scores are as follows. From IGN, 8 out of 10, and then Metacritic, it had a meta score of 90 and a user score of 9 out of 10. So, consensus. Now, by the way, I did a review of Marvel Spider-Man 2. I think that you should go check it out. Because, yeah, well, there are some cracks. We'll put it that way. There are some cracks. I'm going to get into it with the consensus here. A good sequel to an excellent game. This is the consensus. A good sequel to an excellent game. The greatness brought forth from the first title is fun to revisit, although the game does lack real innovations and also suffers from a less interesting open world than the original. So, yes. That's see, I don't want to spoil it because I want you guys to go see my review on all my feelings, good or bad, about it. But I will just say there are. I don't think that the storytelling was done as well. I don't think that the characters were developed as well here as they were in the first game. And while I do still like everything that they brought forward from the first game is still just as good as it was in the first game. So it's still good, but not as good as the first. Alright, so on its profitability, from IGN on November 9th, 2023, Sony has provided a sales update for Marvel's Spider-Man 2, confirming more than 5 million copies sold just 11 days on sale. After 11 days on sale, excuse me. And then this is also from Forbes on December 21st, 2023. Insomniac has been devastated by a hack this week, with essentially the contents of the entire company leaking online. The most eye-popping reveal here is that Marvel Spider-Man 2 cost $300 million to make, an astonishing amount of money, and triple the game's first budget. Those figures, combined with sales that have been reported, mean that even as Sony's stated fastest-selling exclusive ever, it still has not broken even after a flood of initial sales. Not that it won't in time, as a game like this will have a longer tail. Spider-Man 1 was the PS4's best-selling exclusive. Now I'm going to tell you, three times the first game's budget. I want to know why, because, I mean, I appreciate the game itself, but a lot of what it is carried over from the first game. And it's a little bit of a larger map, but it's greatly encompassed in the same area. What I'm trying to say is that I can imagine, like, modders. You hear a lot about modders taking games and doing things with them. If a modder in his free time were to get this game, he could probably have an easier time creating a Spider-Man 2 or 3 from the first game on a much less budget, just simply because you could take the first game and expand it a little, add a few new characters, do a couple of different things, and you would end up with this game. So how did it cost $300 million to make? I'm not saying that it shouldn't have cost the same, or maybe even a little more than the first game, but three times as much? That's a little bit odd for me. I don't understand that. Personally, I don't understand it. If you have thoughts on it, let me know in the comment section down below. Okay, so then, going over to movies. So, October movies, we got Killers of the Flower Moon. Killers of the Flower Moon released on October 20th, 2023. So, its production companies were Apple Studios, Imperative Entertainment, Sequelia Productions, and Appian Way. The review scores from IMDb was 7.7 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes are as follows. So the critics, the top critics gave it a 96%. All critics gave it a 93%. And then from audiences, verified audiences gave it an 84%. And all audiences gave it a 78%. On Metacritic, it had a Metascore of 89. And its user score was 7.7 out of 10. The consensus that I found was that critics praised the movie for its social and political narratives. Even positive reviews from audiences say that the movie was 45 minutes to an hour too long, and that while it was well acted, written, and shot, it is a predictable and generic story that we have heard a thousand times before. I didn't see the movie, so I don't have a whole lot to say about it, but I will just say, like, look, I think that people in Hollywood who get success maybe get a little high on themselves, which is what I also think happened to Napoleon as well. And so they get a little pretentious, they maybe overindulge themselves, And it's not to say that they're necessarily bad, but you can stretch a little bit too. You can stretch yourself a little bit too far when it comes to indulging what you want to do with a property. Okay, so from its profitability, though, from Variety on October 21st, 2023, Killers of the Flower Moon sports a colossal $200 million production budget, but it's not like those behind the feature are banking on a hefty profit from tickets. Apple, which backed the project, is planning to invest in theatrical runs for its original slate as a means to promote their eventual streaming releases. So what they're saying is that Apple funded the movie and released it into theaters so that way it can go to, like it can be seen by a bunch of people and then go to its streaming service, and then you'll want to, after having seen it in theaters, want to watch it on the streaming service. I don't know exactly how that's going to work. Apple has teams of people who are probably smarter than me figuring out their marketing, and that's fine. But from, I will say this, from Box Office Mojo, domestically it made $67 million. Internationally it made $89 million, with a total worldwide box office of $156 million. Now, I am not saying the whole number, because it's actually $156,770,778. But I'm just going to say $156 million. Okay, so we've talked about that. We talk about this every time. I'm just going to mention it for people who are maybe new. You need at least double the production budget to break even, and then you need more than that to make money. So in order to make money, well, in order to break even, it needed probably at least $400 million. And then probably to make money, they probably wanted about $500 million, $500 million. And it didn't do that. But it's going to be on Apple's streaming service, so maybe that offsets the hit, like as far as how bad they feel about the movie's performance, because now they have something to put on their streaming service, which is their stated intent here. So I don't know how it works, but anyway. Okay, so then the second movie in October, Five Nights at Freddy's, was released on October 27, 2023. Its production companies were Universal Pictures, Blumhouse Productions, or Blumhouse Productions, Scott Cawthorn Productions. And Scott Cawthorn Productions. Its review scores are as follows. From IMDb, it was 5.5 out of 10, and Rotten Tomatoes break down like this. From critics, the top critics were 23%, all critics were 32%, audiences verified was 79%, and all audiences were 89%. On Metacritic, it got a 33 Metascore and a user score of 7.9 out of 10. The consensus that I found is that critics dislike the movie, saying that it is slow-paced, ridiculous, but not funny, and not scary, although being called a horror flick. Audiences said that it was a well-made... Audiences say that it was well-made and stays true to the spirit and story of the games, delivering a fun watch for fans of the franchise and a good introduction for those who are unfamiliar with it. So audiences and critics did not agree on this one. I've heard a couple of reviewers on YouTube didn't like it as well. I didn't see it myself, but audiences have liked it, at least moderately. So, as far as its profitability, from Variety on November 5th, 2023, Five Nights at Freddy's earned far more than anyone had expected with its $80 million opening weekend. So the second weekend ticket sales are still decent for the $20 million budgeted film, which landed simultaneously on the streaming service Peacock. So we have seen movies crash and burn this year terribly, and especially when they go to a streaming service first, because people will go just watch in the streaming service instead of paying to see it on theater, in theaters. This movie is a lower budget movie that didn't require much money, and it also released on a streaming service. These are all of the, you know, this is like, what seems like it would be the perfect storm to lose money here. But the ticket here is just that it didn't need much money. It didn't need much money to break even and make money. So $20 million budget, probably needed about $40 million after marketing and everything, and it made $80 million in its opening weekend. Yeah, if that is not just success, I don't know what to tell you. Like, critics can say what they want. Other reviewers can say what they want. The movie made money, and honestly, the audience that it was marketed to liked it. So what am I to say? You know, see, that's a different. There's a difference in the situation as far as movies like we've seen historically, like Captain Marvel, where it made money. Okay, and critics liked it. But then audiences who went and saw it actually didn't seem like they liked it. And if you think that they did, why didn't they show up for the second one? So, anyway. From Box Office Mojo, though, as far as its profitability, it domestically made $137 million. Internationally, it made $152 million. And worldwide box office was $289 million. It made more than... almost made 15 times its budget. That is more detail than we're in. Fallout 4. 16 times the detail. Wasn't that? Yeah, that was from Fallout 4, right? Or was it Fallout New Vegas? Anyway, so... Five Nights at Freddy's. Good on you guys for it. And they've already started to make a sequel. Good on you guys for your success. So moving on to November titles. All right, as we talked about before, RoboCop Rogue City. I did the Rapid Action review. We're going to talk about how it did critically and as far as audience reception and profitability here now. It was released, RoboCop Rogue City was released on November 2nd, 2023. It was developed by Taeon and published by Nacon. The review scores are as follows. From IGN, it was 7 out of 10. PC Gamer was 65%. Metacritic, on Metacritic, it got a meta score of 72 and a user score of 8.6. So all of that seems pretty positive so far. So I read the reviews and let's see what consensus that I found. The game is a well-made B-tier throwback to a bygone era. While it never does anything amazing, it does a great job capturing the spirit of the movies and delivering the power fantasy of being a walking tank with a badge and a heart. Yeah, I really enjoyed this game. I thought that it was interesting. It would be cool to see them do more in the future with something like this. Even if they don't do, like, even if it's something where they say, you know, we don't want to revisit RoboCop because of the movies and messing with the lore or whatever, it would be cool to see them make a game possibly that is similar to this one and has aspects like this, you know, aspects of gameplay and storytelling that they have here. So, on the game's profitability, from Game World Observer on November 22nd, 2023. So, according to Nacon, RoboCop Rogue City has been played by over 435,000 users in the first 2 weeks since its launch on November 2nd. The company CEO, Elaine Falk, noted that the game exceeded our expectations and became its best ever launch. RoboCop Rogue City received mixed to positive reviews from critics, with its average score on Metacritic ranging from 72 PS5 to 75 on the PC. It is also available on Xbox Series X and S. Player reception, however, has been way more warm. The game currently has a very positive rating on Steam, with 92% of the 3,210 user reviews being positive. Many praised the gameplay and the developer's lovely tribute to the style and atmosphere of the source material, Paul Verhoeven's classic film RoboCop. Exactly. So, like I said, fans are really loving it because it really is RoboCop. Okay, moving on to the next game, though. Gangs of Sherwood, releasing on the PlayStation 5, Microsoft, Windows, Xbox Series X, and Series S, was released on October 19th. It, like I said before, it had been delayed from November 27th, 2023. It was developed by Appeal Studios and published by Nacon. The review scores for the game are as follows. From PC Gamer, 50%. ZTGD, 6.5. And Steam, 6 out of 10. The consensus that I found is that the game is a steampunk action-adventure hack-and-slash with fantasy elements set in the world of Robin Hood. It is short at only 5 hours. It is co-op focused and definitely more fun to play with friends. It is an interesting idea, and there is fun to be had, but overall, this is a passable but unremarkable title with its share of flaws. So people were not exactly impressed, so much so that I could not find any sales numbers or articles on its success, except from Steambase.com, I found that the game... the game's all-time peak players is 187. So no more than 187 players played this game at a time. And yeah, basically it's just, you know what it, you know what the problem with it is that if you the single player campaign is very short and it's designed after co-op play. Not exactly multiplayer, but it's in the same realm. And so if you don't have a good single player experience, people are only going to be able to play it with friends or online or whatever it is, however you've structured that, whether co-op or multiplayer. And that just cuts down your audience base. And then as time goes on, it just drops off faster. I can still go buy games that came out 20 years ago that are single player and play them. I'm not going to be able to play this game in co-op with my buddies in a year. That's what I'm saying. Okay, so the movies. First November movie is The Marvels. It was released on November 10th. Its production company is Marvel Studios. The review scores for the movie from IMDb are 5.6 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes, the critics, from breakdown is the critics, all critics gave it a 62%. Top critics gave it a 42%. Audience, verified, gave it an 82%, and all gave it a 68%. And then looking at the Metacritic, the Metascore was 50, the user score 3.8. Now I'm going to tell you, Rotten Tomatoes tends to be... When I look at these, I look at Rotten Tomatoes and I say, look, Rotten Tomatoes is the least reliable. They've had problems with deleting reviews and certain things. I think that they are basically the most susceptible to manipulation at this point, because of their stance on dealing with certain entities in the movie and video game business. And so I will say that most likely the 5.6 from IMDb and the 50% Metascore and the 3.8 out of 10 user score on Metacritic are probably more accurate than the 82 and 68 audience score. Yeah. So let's check it out. The consensus that I found from reading many of the reviews is that this is another step in the downward spiral staircase that is the MCU. The film is uninteresting and not as action-packed, funny, or well-written as it tries to be, or possibly thinks that it is. Yeah, the thing is that it's not even about... It's not about how well the movie is made per se, as far as the acting or the writing. Okay, guys, I'm sorry. I had to stop it there and cut because I've got some stuff going on while I'm recording this outside of YouTube stuff. But I did just want to point out, I do apologize, by the way, for the cuts. Hopefully we won't have any more. I realized as I was dealing with all of that my blue cord from the infantry was not on my thing because I removed it. I had to put on my ASUs. My dress uniform to go to an event, my dad's retirement ceremony, and I put it back now, so that's why it's there. Anyway, where was I? So yes, Captain Marvel. This is what I was saying. So basically, here's the thing you guys have to realize about this, is that these movies are not failing based on their technical aspects. Anybody can film somebody punching somebody, or, you know. I realize that there is technical aspects of it. Like, if I made a movie where it was... If I, like, myself, with this camera, made a movie where it was just me doing action scenes, you know, that wouldn't be so great that people would love that. but the thing with... that's my point, though, is whether it's technically good or bad, action scenes will not be what is making or breaking the movie. What is making and breaking these movies is... The writing, the characters, the characters that you guys are choosing to make these movies about, I think you're making a mistake. The acting as well. I think that with the Captain Marvel movie and some of the other Marvel movies, there's been some acting that is really, really just not good. We'll just put it that way. Subpar. Disappointing. These are supposed to be huge big box office movies. If you want to get huge big box office, if you want to make $1 billion, I mean, this movie, you've got to make movies that are excellent. I mean, at least high above average. So the thing here was just that the characters just, they weren't so interesting in themselves, but then also what happens in this movie wasn't so interesting. And so my point is that even with those two things, even if the acting was great and the dialogue was all great and the writing, you know, as far as that, it just wasn't so, it's such an interesting story. And that's the whole thing. So, I've always said that if you put two very good actors into an empty elevator and just filmed it, they have the, you know, that could create a good movie. But the thing is that it would be based on the interactions that they have with each other being interesting. These characters didn't have any interesting interactions. So, yeah, I was just extremely disappointed in this one. Yeah. Let's see how it did financially, though. So, from Box Office Mojo. Oh, no, actually, wait. Here he goes. No, so from Forbes on September 20th, 2023, Disney has revealed that it spent more than $270 million on making the Marvels. And this is what I wanted to point out to you. That was making the Marvels while Marvel Spider-Man 2 cost more. It cost more. It cost $300 million to make. And one second, I'm just looking because it was way back here. Yeah, it cost $300 million to make. The Marvels cost $270 million, and Marvel Spider, that's the point that I was making about Marvel Spider-Man 2 being so weird how expensive it was, because it's a repackaging and an upgrade, don't get me wrong, of the first game. Like it is a sequel to the first game, but it happens in the same place with a lot of the same characters. We already had a DLC. Where, or not a DLC, but, you know, an offshoot game where you played both characters. So we've played both characters from Spider-Man 2 before. Why didn't they just... It seems to me, not why didn't they, but it seems to me that they could have just imported those characters into the same game at the same time and had a lower production cost. Anyway, sorry, I'm getting on a tangent here. So anyway, yeah, so Disney has revealed that it spent more than $270 million on making the Marvels, the latest installment in its Marvel Comics superhero saga, which will be released in theaters in November. So now, in November, when it was released from Box Office Mojo, it domestically made $84 million, not even $100 million. Internationally, it made $110 million. Worldwide, it made $195 million. That will make it the first Marvel movie. So the production spent was $270 million. You double that to break even because of marketing costs. This is the first Marvel movie to not even make back its production cost. Forget about marketing for a second. It didn't even make back its production cost. And you know the thing that bothers me is internal, like test audiences, internal projections are usually very accurate. That's something I learned I know I gotta get a haircut. I'm sorry, guys. That's the second time I mentioned my hair needing to be cut. I'm gonna get a cut. Don't worry. but yeah, internal projection. Something I learned about it from listening to some political news and things like that is that actually, like during an election year, internal polling is very accurate, way more accurate. My understanding is that it's usually way more accurate than polling done in the public that public people will hear about. So usually when it comes to politics, at least politics, they have much better numbers as far as what the outcome of an election is going to be within the people who are running. Okay, like the people who are running will have way better information on that. I don't know exactly all of the details of how it works, but I would think that Marvel had to have known that there was a great chance this movie was not going to do well. And I mean, even from the production cost. So basically, it made $200 million. It needed to make $270 million just to beat its production cost. It probably needed to make $540 million to make any money to actually break even. And then it probably needed $700 to $750 million to actually make money. So this movie actually lost... This movie actually lost almost like $300 million. If I could not imagine being the person who has to sign off on releasing a movie or making it or anything, like just and knowing, like the marketing budget, I would have just said, look, forget it. We'll lose $70 million instead of $300 million and we just won't market it. We'll cancel the movie. I don't know. I cannot imagine being the guy who has to sign off on releasing this movie and paying for marketing knowing that there's a great, great likelihood it's going to lose that much money. I can't imagine it. Anyway, the next movie was Napoleon. Now, again, we did do an after-action review of this with Tommy Boy. It was released on November 22nd, 2023. The studios were Apple Studios, Moving Picture Company, and Scott Free Productions. Review scores are as follows. IMDb was 6.5 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes from the critic side, all critics was 58%. Top critics, 57%. Audience verified, 59%. And all audiences, 48%. From Metacritic, the Metascore was 64, with user score being 4.7. So, like I said, usually if there's one that, you know, if Rotten Tomatoes doesn't match up with the other two, I disregard it, because Rotten Tomatoes is the least accurate. But actually, it's all kind of falling in the same area here. Basically, this was an average to below average movie according to the review scores, even the audiences. The consensus that I found is that the film has great production value, which is what we praised in our review of it. The film has great production value with amazing action set pieces, expert cinematography, a top-tier cast of actors, and second-to-none costume and makeup design. Unfortunately, outside of the battle scenes, very strange decisions were made. And that, my friends, is putting it lightly. The movie is quite inaccurate historically and depicts Napoleon as being extremely odd in his personal life, almost to the point of spoofing the character, the actual historical character. This movie almost, it dipped into parody. Like it was comedic parody almost. The profitability here from Screen Rant on November 20th, 2023, according to the Hollywood Reporter, Napoleon's production budget is around $200 million. That is a vast sum, although not absurd for a historical epic, particularly one centered on military conquest. I will tell you that $200 million, it's interesting because there was only a few battles in it, and the battles were good, but there was only a few of them. So from Box Office Mojo, domestically it made $61 million. Internationally it made $157 million, leading to a worldwide box office haul of $219 million. Again, another one that lost basically $200 million. It just barely surpassed its production budget, but did not break even due to marketing costs. So, ooh, man. So, moving on to December, we had, on the video game side of things, we had the Dragon Quest Monsters, The Dark Prince, which came out for Switch. It was released on December 1st, 2023. It was developed by Square Enix and Tosei. T-O-S-E, and it was published, like Tosa, that's the name of the developer, and published by Square Enix. Review scores are as follows. So for Metacritic, it was a 72, the Metascore was a 72, and then user score was 8.5 out of 10. Now, I couldn't find any other reliable review scores, so just Metacritic for this one. The consensus that I found for the game is that the game is a fun, monster-catching RPG with an addictive gameplay loop. While it is nothing amazing, it is a well-made spin-off of the Dragon Quest games. For those looking for an alternative to the Pokemon franchise, you should consider picking this one up. For fans of the Dragon Quest games, this is a must-have. So if you're a fan of the franchise, go check it out. If you're looking for something a little bit different from Pokemon, hey, it might be worth looking into. So from on the profitability side of things, I did not find any specific numbers on this, but from Nintendo Life on February 1st, 2024, Square Enix's monster-catching spin-off, Dragon Quest Monsters: The Dark Prince, got off to a strong start last month when it arrived on the Switch. Just a second. That doesn't make sense. I must have messed that up. My bad, guys. That is a typo. It's January. January 1st, 2024. My bad. So Square Enix's monster... So this was from January 1st, 2024. Square Enix's monster-catching spin-off, Dragon Quest Monsters: The Dark Prince, got off to a strong start last month when it arrived on the Switch, with the game topping the charts in Japan and also selling out in certain locations around the world. Now, in an update, it's been revealed the combined digital and physical sales of the game have now surpassed the 1 million mark worldwide. So that's good. For a game like a Switch game, a million sales might actually be good, depending on how much of a budget that they put into it. So I believe that they are actually happy with it, with some of the other stuff that I've read that I can't source because it's not like sourceable stuff. But I think that they're actually happy with this. So that looks, good for them. That looks great. All right, moving on here. So we have Avatar: Frontiers of Pandora coming out on the PlayStation 5, Xbox Series X and Series S, Microsoft Windows, and Amazon Luna. Now, this is one that... Basically, what happened, guys, is it came out, I started playing it, we went on Christmas vacation, came back, had all kinds of stuff because it was the beginning of the year, including this action update, the Mars Summit, and we've just been very, very bad. It was supposed to come out at the end of January, now it's the middle of February, and we are going to be doing it next week. So it's February 16th today, and we will be doing the review for this between myself... And Lore Master Brian will be doing this next week sometime. But anyway, the game was released on December 7th. The developers were Massive Entertainment, Ubisoft Dusseldorf, Fox Next, Ubisoft Shanghai, Massive Entertainment AB. It was published by Ubisoft. The review scores are as follows. From IGN, 7 out of 10. From PC Gamer, 50%. And from PC World, 4 out of 5. The consensus that I found was that Frontiers of Pandora has a beautifully crafted open world. Having said that, the combat is nothing amazing, the gameplay is okay but repetitive, and the narrative is nothing to write home about. It's your average Far Cry game set in the world of Pandora with few surprises or unique features. Yeah, so there are a few surprises, and there are a few unique features, but there's not that many. Your character can fly. You've seen all the stuff with Pandora, and it's really cool to explore. It's basically a Far Cry game, role-playing in the Pandora in the Avatar universe. So that's the reviewer consensus. That is not our... Like Mike's After Action Review specific thoughts. We're going to get into that in our review next week. Profitability. So we did not actually have any sales data for this. I was trying to find stuff. I just could not find anything. Not anything that could be sourced anyway. So, I mean, like I found stuff on forums and whatever, but it wasn't reliable or accurate. Reliably accurate. So from Forbes on December 18th, though, 2023, there is a long list of games that deserved better. Solid offerings that were killed by poor release dates, a lack of promotion, or both, and I think we may soon need to add Avatar: Frontiers of Pandora to that list. Avatar is getting higher user scores than any Far Cry or Assassin's Creed in recent memory, but has been almost erased from the gaming discourse, and it seems likely that sales are not amazing as a result. The game has been out less than 2 weeks, and it's Physical copies have already been put on sale with huge discounts. From what I can tell, most retailers from Target to Amazon currently have the $70 Avatar Frontiers of Pandora on sale for 30%, or 29% off, at $50. But if you go get, sorry, if you go to Best Buy instead, the game is actually just $40, a full 42% off the original $70 price instead. So, look, like I said, it's okay. I'm talking about the reviewer's consensus here, is that it's okay, nothing amazing or anything, but the user scores actually are pretty good. So, you know, I think it might be right. I think it was an okay game that got done dirty by whatever factors and just was not financially successful, even though it was not a bad or terrible game in any way. Okay, so then moving on to movies, we have Godzilla Minus One coming to theaters on December 1st, 2023. Production was from the Toho Pictures and Robot Communications. Review scores are as follows from IMDb. It was an 8.3 out of 10. Metacritic, it had a Metascore of 81 and a user score of 8.3 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes breaks down like this. Critics, all critics, 98%. Top critics, 100%. Audience, verified, 98%. All audience, 97%. And I'm going to tell you, basically, that's what I've seen. I know that IMDb says 8.3, and I know Metacritic, and usually I say that Rotten Tomatoes is the least accurate. But everywhere that I've talked to, like all of my non-sourced sources, okay, as far as YouTube creators, forums, people talking about it, just everything I've seen has been that this is an excellent movie, more towards the 95% plus score than an 8. 8 out of 10 or an 80% score. So, yeah. The consensus that and this is the consensus I found from all of these reviews, is that Godzilla Minus One is an excellent film that has been highly praised by critics and audiences. Nearly every aspect of the movie is expertly crafted. It's an enthralling spectacle with genre-defining special effects and high-octane action, while also being grounded by very entertaining story and well-acted human element. By a very entertaining story and well-acted human element, excuse me, all on a comparatively low budget. So, from the profit, talking about profitability, from Screen Rant on February 5th, 2024, Toho has not officially disclosed how much Godzilla Minus One cost to make, but a $15 million budget has been associated with the movie. The information comes from one of the movie's rave reviews, as Variety called it a $15 million enterprise. But director Takashi Yamazaki denied that via comic book by saying, "I wish it were that much. The reported Godzilla Minus One budget is significantly lower than most modern Hollywood movies, especially blockbusters that boast a similar scale. To put the much lower cost into perspective, the MonsterVerse movies have all had budgets at least 10 times as large." So when you see even previews of this, you can see that it is this big movie with CGI and a giant monster and practical effects that are really good. Cost less than $15 million. From Box Office Mojo, domestically it made $56 million. Internationally it made $48 million, with a worldwide box office haul of $105 million. That means that it made almost 10 times as much of its money. Seven times its budget, which is excellent. They probably only needed $30 million to break even here. They made 105. That's really great. And I do hear that this is, people were upset that it's getting kind of snubbed from the Golden Globes and from the Oscars, but yeah, I haven't seen it yet because it wasn't in theaters near me. This looks like it's going to be a good one when I finally do see it. And when I do, at some point, I do want to do a review of it. So go check it out, guys. All right. The next one was Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom. Came out on December 20th. From a production standpoint, it was made by Warner Bros., DC Entertainment, Atomic Monster. The review scores from IMDb was a 5.8 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes breaks down as such. Critics from the, so all critics, 34%, top critics, 23%, audience, The verified audience, 81%. All audiences, 69%. Metacritic, it had a Metascore of 42 and a user score of 5.3. And the consensus that I found from reading a bunch of these reviews is that critics disliked the movie, saying that it was silly and fell flat, while audiences said that, while it isn't anything amazing, it's a fun time with solid action, good visuals, and some humor sprinkled in. I think that you should go watch my review before passing judgment on this movie. I didn't think that it was terrible. I didn't think it was super amazing or as good as the last one, but I can tell you I think it was an appropriate sequel. Like, I think that it was of appropriate quality to the first, like, as far as a sequel to the first one. On the profitability side of things is where we're going to take a little bit of a hit here. From Collider on January 22nd, 2023, the final reported production budget for Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom is about $205 million, costing $45 million more than the 2018 Aquaman film. See, now that's appropriate. I just keep coming back to Marvel Spider-Man 2. The first one cost a certain amount of money, $100 million. The second one cost three times that. What an appropriate sequel is this? Like, oh, it was $200 million, which is $45 million more than the first one. See, if they would have said that it was $45 million more than the first one, or $50 million, even $100 million more than the first one for Marvel Spider-Man 2, that would make sense to me. But three times the cost? I mean, $100 million would have been stretching it, but three times the cost? That just seems so odd to me. It's a conundrum. Anyway, so costing $45 million more than the 2018 Aquaman film, with a marketing budget likely ending up around $100 to $150 million, Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom must make somewhere between $305 and $355 million to break even. Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom will need a final take of $510 to $555 million to be considered a box office success. Okay, so from Box Office Mojo, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Domestically, it made $118 million. Internationally, it made $294 million, with a total worldwide box office of $412 million. So what that means is, it probably broke even, made a tiny amount of money, but wouldn't be considered as a... See, that's what you need to realize. If it breaks even, that's not a success. If it breaks even and makes $1, that's not a success. If a $400 million movie breaks even and makes $5 million, that is not a success. It needs to make a couple hundred million dollars more to be a success, and this just wasn't it. I would think that it would be, like, I know that Jason Momoa is moving on to other projects within the DCEU, but I really would have hoped that would have done well, so that way we can have him come back as Aquaman, or even Orm come back. Orm was really good. I really like, I forget the actor's name off the top of my head, but I liked him. That whole situation just sucks. Amber Heard was in it and kind of ruined the movie. And I think the public perception was really against her. So that sucks. So, anyway, though, let's moving on here. So those are the releases from 2023 that came out during the last quarter. October to January. Now...
Hi, it's Travis with Oscar Mike Radio. Oscar Mike Radio is a military and veterans podcast and show about those who serve our country and those who have served and are doing amazing things.
But you know what? Let's take more. And then they had that fantastic...
Managing those logistics and getting things where they need to be on time.
I mean, come on!
Want to learn more? Want to follow the show? Go to OscarMikeRadio.com or the link below. We're Oscar Mike, and we're Mission in Flight. Thank you.
We are going to move on to what I am currently working on. So, Before we move on, I do want to give a quick apology. Because actually, so for one thing, I do apologize for this being so late. Like I said, I have a lot of things going on right now. Mars Media is the business that I own, that actually owns the YouTube channel, and I have business partners, and we've been expanding and doing some other things, which is great. And you guys supporting us in doing that is awesome. People subscribing, I really, really appreciate all of you guys. Yeah, this is great. Hitting 1,000 subscribers has been great. Awesome. Thank you guys so much. Make sure to always be watching, though, because we need to hit those watch hour targets. That's what I need for the next tier, is watch hours, guys. So anyway, though, my second apology is to Salty Skipper. You're going to see a picture of him back here. So when we did the Mars Summit, he created for me a logo or a little piece of art, because if you guys didn't know, Disney has lost the rights now to Steamboat Willie, the original version of Mickey Mouse. And so I went to Steven Salty Skipper and I said, hey, you know, can you make me like a little graphic of my werewolf and Mickey Mouse, you know? And so he made that, and you guys should be seeing it on screen. I'll make sure to edit it in here, but yeah, we were going to use it when we talked about it in the Mars Summit, but we totally did not even mention the Steamboat. Did we mention the Steamboat Willie thing? No, we didn't even mention the Steamboat Willie thing. The Mars Summit really was a great time, but we talked about a lot of stuff, and we didn't really cover that. So I do want to bring that artwork forward and show you guys, hey, you know, if you need help with a project or you need some graphics done, let me know, and I can put you in contact with Salty Skipper. He does the comic book art, and he does some really great stuff. So, yeah, I hope you guys like that work. There it is, Steamboat Willie and my werewolf. That's an alpha member of the pack right there, showing Disney the business. Anyway, what I'm currently working on. So we just did our very first interview with a game developer. I want to thank Flat28 for talking with us. Flat28 is a gaming collective, is what they call themselves, which is basically, they're a volunteer group of people, about 16 people, who are making a CRPG called Glasshouse. CRPG being classic RPG. So think Dungeons and Dragons, but translated to computer, which is, you know, Baldur's Gate just recently came out. This is a perfect example of what a CRPG is. Theirs is not exactly like that. It's smaller scale. They're a smaller company. But I'm telling you guys, it looks very interesting. It has some interesting game mechanics, and I think that it's going to be really fun to play. You can get a demo right now on Steam, and you can wishlist the game. Yeah, go check it out. Support them. Go check out my interview. You should be seeing a card popping up somewhere. Think over there by Iron Man, or maybe... No, it's going to be over there by Iron Man. Okay, yeah, check that out. And now if I don't point over here to Thor and say it might be over Thor, I'm going to look like a real idiot. I look like an idiot anyway. Whatever, guys. We're doing this live. This is show business. You got to be ready to get a little silly. Anyway, also, though, as I said before, I got Avatar Frontiers of Pandora, the after action interview with Lore Master Brian. We're doing that in an interview format because, honestly, I like working with my dad. Lore Master Brian is one of my partners in business here for Mars Media, and he's also, he's my dad, and I love him, and it's great to hear his input because he's been playing games for a really long time, and while I basically played through the main campaign, streamlined the main campaign of the game, he went more in-depth with the side content, and we are going to bring those two aspects of the game together and talk about it in an interview style thing. I didn't have time to do the after action review, basically. And so this is a good compromise, and I get to work with my dad, so that's cool. Okay, also, Tommy Boy actually is currently, let me see, what time is it? I can tell you right now. Tommy Boy is currently in the movie theater, or he's going to be on his way to the movie theater. See, I'm going to text him right now. Everybody say hi to Tommy Boy in the comments section. Yeah, let me see. So I'm texting him. I'm saying good luck. Good luck at Madam Web. So he is currently going to see Madam Web. I saw it on opening day. And we're going to do an after action review together. So you will probably be seeing that next week, the 22nd. Yeah, because it's today's the 16th. 17th, 18th. Yeah, from the 19th on, probably during, like, from the 19th on. So before the end of next week, you guys will be seeing that. I don't know how, you know, how that'll be in, like, the release date will be in relation to this video. So anyway, is it as bad as they say it is? Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it is. And by the time that you guys see this, the review will probably be just a day or two away. We're going to talk about it. Just save your money. Watch our review instead. And then also, guys, listen, we hit 1,000 subscribers, and when we hit, and I've had these milestone goals, it was 100 subscribers, we did $50, 250 subscribers, I gave away $100, 500 subscribers, I gave away $250, and now we're at 1,000 subscribers, and I am going to be giving away 500 big ones. So, thank you guys so much for supporting us in this endeavor to make Mike's After Action Reviews a successful YouTube channel and allowing me to do the things that I want to do in my, you know, semi-retirement here out of the military. This is so great. So we'll be putting that video out. Basically, what's going to happen is I'm going to put a video out on YouTube, and then the video itself will be instructions on how to get the money, how to enter the cash giveaway and be entered into that. So it'll be random. So do not message me and say, please make me the winner, please make me the winner, please make me the winner. I'm going to tell you guys, don't worry about bots. I've gotten experienced with figuring out who is a bot and who is a real person and a real subscriber. So, yes. Okay, so that's what we're currently working on. Let's talk about some stuff going on moving forward. So,
my name is Stephen Russell. My co-writer, Joseph Miles Pittman, and I would like you to imagine a graphic narrative that disrupts the superhero genre's conventional boundaries. Tales of Nihilism unfolds a thought-provoking anthology with diverse story formats from succinct comic strips to multi-saga issues. But at its core, The Ballad of Philip Kirschner explores existential challenges of an ordinary man in a world inundated with superheroes. The anthology challenges prevailing hero worship narratives, diving deep into societal introspection. We invite readers to confront uncomfortable truths about our culture's obsession with saviors and question the prevailing societal structures. The series is not just a comic, but an invitation to contemplate, challenging readers to reassess their perspectives on heroism and societal norms. It's an opportunity to offer audiences a fresh, introspective take on the superhero universe, sparking conversations, reflections on the human condition. You can find the series digitally on Global Comics or follow the links below to get your own physical issue.
I need help. I do. I need help. I need partners in making videos. I actually feel really bad because there was a buddy who came on and he actually recorded a movie review, a full movie review. And I just honestly, the op tempo here, the operations tempo, the speed at which things have been happening, I've been so far behind. I have not recovered since that guy I'm not going to give his name or anything because I'm going to talk about it when we release the review. But we have a old war movie that this person, this member of the Action Pack, actually was in as an extra. And I interviewed him about his experiences and how the movie was. And I haven't been able to finish the review so that way I can put it out. But it's coming, guys. It is coming. So, I need help. I need partners in making videos. If that's something that you're interested in, let me know. You can also financially support us. So aside from getting involved, I'm also always looking for people to stream on the Twitch. So everybody that I've known that actually works on the YouTube channel currently are people that I know in person. But hey, I mean, if you have a YouTube channel and you want to collaborate, or you have a small YouTube channel and you want to work with my YouTube channel on making videos together, and maybe I can do some stuff for you and you can do some stuff for me and we can kind of become a team here, I'm totally down. Let's do it, you know? Yeah, so the other ways that you can support are financially supporting us. We have YouTube memberships. You'll get videos early, a day early, and then your name in the credits. We have the merchandise sales, so you can get our... Let me see. I got to go over like this. I love this mic because it just creates like a cool setup for us. But at the same time, you can't really see my shirt on this, but... Go check out, you can get the merchandise. We have all kinds of cool merchandise. We even have we have wall hangings that look pretty cool, and they have the Mars on them. Yeah, so check all that out. We have Twitch subscription. It's a couple bucks a month, but I will tell you that, so for one thing, you'll skip the ads when I'm live streaming on Twitch. When I live stream daily on Twitch, like actually do gameplay, I do not do go to intermission during the ads that play. So you can skip, like you'll actually be missing some of the live stream unless you are a member. So subscribed over on Twitch, other than just following me. So follow me. Following is the same thing as subscribing on YouTube, and then subscribing on Twitch is like becoming a channel member on YouTube. So, but anyway, at 10 subscriptions, we're gonna do a $50 cash giveaway over on Twitch. So go over there and do that. We also have the Patreon. I think honestly, the Patreon is the best way to support. Other than the, like, if you want something for your money, buy merch. Otherwise, if you just want to support, Patreon. Okay. The Patreon will also get your name in the credits. And I've got to do something where I can. I think what I'll do is I'll start uploading. Because now that I have a membership and you get it from a day early, the patrons should get something like that too. So that'll be something we're looking into as we move forward. How to equalize membership on YouTube versus Patreon. So being a patron. So we'll figure that out. Okay, so then, and then also the other thing is that on Fiverr. So I said this before. I actually am, so I'm a YouTube channel. And it evolved into an advertising business that I've actually started. So I have an official LLC called Mars Media, and we do advertising for local businesses and online retailers. When I say local businesses, I mean we do it for businesses, okay? Usually smaller businesses, local at this time as we get bigger and more successful, obviously things will grow. But also online retailers. So, as part of that, I have a Fiverr where I do advertising on my YouTube channel. So you'll see sponsorships put into like my trailer reactions and things like that. I gotta stop saying things like that because people don't actually know what that means. sponsorships on my videos, my reviews, my trailer reactions. It's plans start at $5. They go all the way up to $50 for an ad read. That would be where, like, I'm sitting here like this and I tell you about a product. Or there's a more expensive option that is where I actually create, like, a high production value commercial. So check that out if you're interested. If you have a business or something, let us know. mikesafterextrareviews@gmail.com. You can send us an email and we will take care of you. Yeah, so then the other thing that we're working on so as we move forward here is monetization on YouTube at tier 2. So once we hit that second tier of monetization, we're going to start getting a consistent cash flow from ad revenue. And as I've always promised, and I'm going to hold to that promise, is that we're going to do 10% of our ad revenue is going to go into an account or be kind of demarcated separately. And then once that demarcated amount of money reaches $200. Once it reaches at least $20, we're going to give it away at the end of the quarter. So if it hits $10, that gets rolled over into the next quarter. If it hits $20, then the next quarter we'll give away the $20. If it hits $20 and keeps going and hits $1,000, we'll give away $1,000 the next quarter. I'm going to figure out how to do it as far as tax liability, because I think that you can basically give away $500 without some kind of tax thing or whatever. And if that's the case, then we'll do, depending on how much money we start making from ad revenue, we'll do $500 cash giveaways. Just $500, like one or two $500 cash giveaways, however many we need to do to give away that amount of money, okay? Or we can give away merch. We can, as moving forward, let me know in the comments what you guys want with that. any ideas that you have that would be good. But basically, we are going to be giving away 10% of the money that we make from ad revenue here on YouTube. And that is a promise. Unless something amazing happens or some legal thing comes in and stops me from doing that, that is exactly what I'm going to do. So the other thing is that we want to do more product reviews. So I'm the only one that does anything. That is the truth. That's why I said I need help making videos. Tommy Boy is started to get into it. I have my sister, Amber. She's going to be doing some gameplay of some Switch games and recording that and then possibly doing the review with me. But basically, what the thing is here is that I don't always have the time to do, you know, 1 to 2 movie reviews a month, excuse me, and then also at least one video game a month. As it is, adding product reviews to that becomes difficult. And that's the other thing. Well, I'll tell you about this in just a second. Adding product reviews to that is going to be difficult. But I have Tommy Boy who said that he may do is interested in doing some reviews as much as he can. And my sister already said that. So we want to be able to get more product reviews done. As we grow and as I get more people who can help me, we can do more. And the product reviews are really popular, and so we want to be able to get into that. So watch for those. The other thing is that I've been doing... So basically, last action update, I said that I would be releasing after-action reports on the blog on Wednesdays. What has happened with that is that, for one thing, just a whirlwind... Like, immediately after the last action update, a whirlwind of things happened. And the other thing is that I'm partnering with Staff Sergeant Matt. He's helping me build a website. And Staff Sergeant Matt is somebody who's worked with me in the past on the YouTube channel. But he's going to actually help me build a website. And so the blog has been temporary. Like, it's still up. But we're just not using it right now because we are about to launch our own website. And the blog will be a part of that. So... Blog posts for now, don't watch for them. I'm trying to find people, you know, if you're interested in writing one, let me know. That was the whole idea, is that I would write every once in a while, but that would be mostly community driven, and then I would be editing the reviews, and we would go back and forth between editorializing your review, and then I would post it when you give me the thumbs up about it, and you would be credited. And if we earned any money from it, you would... Take the money. I don't care. Take the money. It's whatever. But anyway, okay. So that's what we're doing moving forward. New website, more product reviews, monetization. Please help us. If you want to support us, if you want to get involved more as far as writing written reviews for the blog or whatever, fan submissions are going to be much appreciated. But moving on here, we have the 2024 releases. So this is the release schedule for 2024. I have a lot, so I'm going to read through these very quickly here and try to get this. I know this video, see, that's the thing. I knew this video was going to be really long anyway. So you just accept it and move forward. How are we at? We're at 43 minutes right now. So this video is probably going to be as long as a movie. Here we go, though. So, in February, right now, today, it is February 16th. Skull and Bones, it has released today for the PS5, Xbox Series S and X, and the PC. So, from its production, it's developed by Ubisoft Singapore and published by Ubisoft. I will be going, after this video is done, picking up the game, and I think I'm going to call Tommy Boy again, see if he messaged me. Oh, he did. Let's see what he said. He says... LOL, I said, good luck at Madam Web. He said, LOL, LOL, I'm going to need it. Yes, okay. So hopefully he does okay at Madam Web. But I think I'm going to message him, see if, because he got the game as well. And we're going to play it together, possibly live streaming it. We'll see how we can get it to go. Okay, then we have Terminator Dark Fate. Defiance. It's releasing on PC, so it was to be announced, and now it has moved to February 21st, so it releases in 5 days. It's developed and published by Slytherin Limited. In Europe, they're called Limited, so instead of LLC, instead of Incorporated, it's Limited, so yeah. So on Steam, it was listed as Q4 2024, and then... It's now listed as Q4 2023. It's now listed as February 21st, 2024. So this is from Insider Gaming on November 30th, 2023. It said that Terminator Dark Fate Defiance has officially been delayed until February 21st, 2024, according to a new Steam update. It was originally expected to launch next week on December 7th. This was released on November 30th. Developer Slitherine Games explains that this delay will allow them to refine, polish, and resolve any existing bugs. Slitherine Games was surprisingly specific about the necessary changes. The team will focus on improving multiplayer, server infrastructure, ultra-wide resolution issues, performance, and other quality of life issues. That's actually all other quality of life features. That is really great. I am so glad that they are fixing any issues that they have with the game. They're trying to make it as good as they can, even if it wasn't necessarily broken. I don't know how the game was, but I'm saying, you know, taking a delay and releasing a great game, or at least a good game, is much better than getting a bad game to you quicker. So I'm not going to have any descriptions for everything. It's just that one was to be announced, and we had been tracking that on the to be announced one. So that was the news from that. Other than that, okay, so then February 14th for the movies. We had February 14th was Madame Web. I already went and saw it. It was produced by Sony and directed by S.J. Clarkson. So, review pending. Watch for that one, guys. Then we have March. So in March next month, we have Rise of the Ronin releasing on PS5 on the 22nd. I feel like if I hold the paper up here like this, it's better than sitting down here like this. Okay, so Rise of the Ronin releasing on the PS5 on March 22nd. It's being developed by Team Ninja and published by Sony Interactive Entertainment. I believe, yeah, so that's one that I want to do. So that's going to be my March game, okay? And then on the movie side of things, Dune Part 2 is being released on March 1st. The production company is Warner Bros. And the director is Denis Villeneuve. I'm very excited. We really liked Part 1. You can go check out Part 1's review on the card. Go somewhere. I think it's over here. Go click on that card and you can see. If the card doesn't pop up, I look even more like an idiot. But if it did pop up, go click it after you're done watching this video and see the review for Dune Part 1. Other Mike and I really liked it. Yeah, it was delayed and now it is finally here. So, because of the writer strike is why it was delayed. And the next one was also delayed. Ghostbusters Frozen Empire is being released on March 22nd from Columbia Pictures and being directed by Gil Keenan. I think that this one looks like it's going to be pretty good. It brings back the original cast and does much better than Ghostbusters 2016. Then on March 29th, so I'm trying to see all of these. So I'm going to see Dune Part 2, I'm going to see Ghostbusters Frozen Empire, and then I am also going to go see, I'm going to try anyway, to go see Godzilla X Kong The New Empire, which is releasing on March 29th. It is coming at us from Legendary Entertainment and directed by Adam Wingard. April. So April for video games, we have... April is light. Wow. But for video games, we have Stellar Blade releasing on PS5. There's been some controversy around it because game journalists and certain people who have a certain cultural ideas don't like the fact that even though it is modeled after... The main character is modeled after a real woman using mocap, they don't like that she's a very sexy, beautiful woman. They say that it's distracting and unrealistic how beautiful and sexy her body is. I say, who cares? You guys don't remember the early 2000s when we had awesome action games where men and women were barely clothed while killing monsters and demons. You know, I'm totally down. Let's do it. But anyway, yeah, so Stellar Blade is releasing on April 26th. So if you guys realize, though, what that means is Rise of the Ronin on the 24th, on the 22nd. Yeah, actually, so these games are all spaced about a month apart. So the as far as video games goes, we should be doing okay as our rhythm here. 1 month of playing and then releasing the review. So April 26th, coming at us from developer Shift Up and published by Sony Interactive Entertainment. On the movie side of things, in April, we have The Ministry of Ungentlemanly Warfare. That is being released on April 29th. That's coming at us from Lionsgate Films and being directed by Guy Ritchie. In May, we have Senua's Saga. Now, this is Hellblade 2. Senua Saga, Hellblade 2. Now, I never played the first one. Maybe if I get some time... The first one was supposed to be short, so maybe I can sit down over a weekend and live stream it or play it or whatever and get the experience from the first one, but I do know that it was supposed to be very good. Yeah, so that's coming out... coming to PC and Xbox Series X and S. Now, honestly, it just dropped all of the stuff with Xbox exclusives going to PlayStation. I don't know. I actually have not read up on that too much. So that's going to be, yeah, that's going to be interesting at the end of the year, the Mars Summit. But I'm going to look into that and see if it does come to PlayStation. I will play it on the PlayStation 5. But if not, I'm going to be playing it on PC. It's coming out May 21st. And it is being developed by Team Ninja and published by Xbox Game Studios. All right. Then, on the movie side of things. So, May 3rd, The Fall Guy with Ryan Gosling coming at us from Universal Pictures and directed by David Leitch. David Leitch. So, that is the 3rd. Then, on the 10th, we've got Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes coming out on May 10th. From 20th Century Studios and directed by Wes Ball. Now, I'm going to tell you guys, so like if you look at this, this next one comes out May 24th. So this is going to be a packed schedule for movies, at least. And movies, the movie reviews tend to be longer videos. Like, they're always longer videos. But also, that means more, like, I have to watch them and edit them and... It can be a lot. So my plan is to see all of it. My plan is to see The Fall Guy, Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes, and the next one I'm about to mention, Furiosa, a Mad Max Saga, which is releasing on May 24th. But if I can't, bear with me, okay? Anyway, so Furiosa, Mad Max Saga, May 24th, coming at us from Warner Bros. And being directed by George Miller. Then we have June. I have no video games for June. Can you believe it? In June, we have A Quiet Place Day One. It is releasing on June 28th. It's coming at us from Paramount Pictures and being directed by Michael Sarnowski. And I've loved everything else so far. Jim from The Office is the guy that wrote the first and the second one. I'm not exactly sure how much he might... I don't know if he wrote this one as well. Probably. But he's probably at least going to be an executive producer. That's awesome. No video games in June. See, that's what I'm saying. There's going to be times when I can go back and have a little bit more time to do things. June is a lighter month. But we'll see. Because sometimes as we approach these things... That's why we do these every quarter. As we approach these months, releases are announced that are coming out. And last minute changes and whatever. So... Then we have July. In July, I have no video games, but we have Deadpool 3, which is being called Deadpool and Wolverine. It's not changed on my script because that just came out like 2 days ago and I didn't change it. So it's Deadpool and Wolverine or Wolverine and Deadpool. It'll be behind me. So Deadpool and Wolverine is what we're going with. it's coming out on July 26th. From Walt Disney Studios Motion Pictures and being directed by Sean Levy or Levi. I'm not actually sure on the pronunciation. And people are talking about whether it's going to save the MCU or not. I don't think that it will, even if it's a great movie, because Disney and the MCU are not changing the ways that they... It doesn't seem like they're changing the ways that they've been doing things, which has been leading them down into the dire straits that they're in now. So, then August. So, no video games for July either. So, what is it? June, no video games. May, we have Senua Saga. Then June, no video games. July, no video games. August, Black Myth, Wukong. Coming out on PC, PS5, Xbox Series X and S. August 20th, okay? So the end of August, so we've got some time there where maybe I'll go back and do a retro action review or something. It's coming at us from developer Game Science Interactive Technology, and also that's the publisher as well. I want to get this one. I want to play this one. I'm going to tell you, I'm not into Souls-like games. And my understanding is this is going to be something like that. So hopefully I can get this and be kind of swept up into it a little bit more than I was. Well, more than I was with the Elden Ring and the Souls games and some of the other games that are Souls-likes. So, yeah. August 20th. Then we have Kraven the Hunter coming out on August 30th. That's the day after my birthday. It's coming at us from Sony and being directed by J.C. Chandler. And we will see what happens. I saw Morbius. I saw Madam Web. I saw all the Venom movies, so I've got to see Kraven too. Kraven as well. Okay, so then moving into September, we have Warhammer 40,000 Space Marine 2. I didn't play that. Like, I played a little bit of the first one, but I didn't play through it. I didn't beat it. So maybe during those off months, I'll play, like, Warhammer 40,000 Space Marine, and then in preparation for the second game's release. Okay, so Warhammer 40,000 Space Marine 2 coming at us to PlayStation, PC, Xbox Series X, and S on September 9th. It is coming at us from developer Saber Interactive and published by Focus Entertainment. Then we have an interesting one, Beetlejuice Beetlejuice. This is the Beetlejuice sequel coming to us on September 6th. It is coming from Warner Bros. Production Company and directed by Tim Burton. That'll be interesting. I gotta look into it because my understanding is that at least Michael Keaton is coming back. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. Then we have October. Now, no video games in October, but in October we do have an interesting movie release, Joker, Folie à Deux. I think that's how you pronounce it. That's releasing on October 4th, coming at us from Warner Bros. And being directed by Todd Phillips. I liked the first one. It was gritty. It was sad. We'll see how it goes with the sequel. Then we have November. No video games in November, guys. But Venom 3 coming out November 8th from Sony Production Company, and then directed by Kelly Marcel. The second one, the sequel wasn't so great. The first one was fun. The second one wasn't so great. We'll see what they do with the third. Okay, now in December, they are really beating up some, like, I don't know if you they're really still trying to squeeze as much as they can from some of these franchises. Because in December, we have no video games, but The Lord of the Rings, The War of the Rohirrim is releasing on December 13th from Warner Bros. Pictures and being directed by Kenji Kamiyama. I hope that it does well. I haven't seen anything about it, but just Rings of Power was terrible. But that was Amazon. So I'm wondering. Yeah, I haven't looked into this at all, so I don't know really anything about it. I just hope that it's good, because anything in the Lord of the Rings universe has potential to be good if done right. Then we have Sonic the Hedgehog 3, which is going to be releasing on December 20th, which is interesting because we have Knuckles. Knuckles is coming out, the series, and so it looks like they're doing a thing where they have one movie, and then like they have the spin-off character in the series, probably that spin-off series, I hope that what they do is kind of like keep it in its own self-contained, so that way you don't have to see it to see the movie, because that's just always nice. But then Sonic the Hedgehog 3 will come out, and it's kind of cool. If it's really good, having a lot of an intellectual property is really good if it is good. So hopefully it is good. December 20th, Sonic Hedgehog 3, coming at us from Paramount Pictures and being directed by Jeff Fowler. So, all right, now we have some to-be-announced games that we've been tracking, and we do actually have some interesting stuff here from that. And, we have some interesting stuff here. So let's check it out. To be announced. All right. These are in order of, like, if I know that they're going to be a long way away, they're in the back. The ones that we're not sure of or that we know are releasing earlier are in the front. So here we go. The Wolf Among Us 2 is coming to PC, PlayStation, and Xbox. This is a new one that we have not been tracking, but it just recently in the last quarter has been announced. or at least, you know, like it has a release date. So it is coming at us from Telltale Games and being published by From Telltale as well. So from Game Rant on January 2nd, 2024, after nearly 10 years following the concluding fifth episode of Telltale Games, The Wolf Among Us, which was great. The Wolf Among Us 2 is finally slated for a 2024 release. The Wolf Among Us 2 was originally expected to be released in 2018, but was canceled due to internal challenges at Telltale that resulted in a widespread closure. The developer and The Wolf Among Us were later reacquired by LCG Entertainment, and the sequel to the hugely successful episodic adventure is gone. Is now being developed by both Telltale Games and Ad Hoc Studio. The game has gone through an extremely difficult development cycle, and those issues persisted even into 2023, when it was announced that The Wolf Among Us 2 would be delayed to 2024. Thankfully, the game is still on track for a 2024 release, but a specific release date has yet to be disclosed by the developer. Telltale Games has really been going through some trouble, and that really does suck, because some of those games are really good, including The Wolf Among Us, which I think is probably just the best of them. Really, I haven't played them all, but my understanding, kind of the consensus that I get, is that The Wolf Among Us was top tier. Star Wars Outlaws, coming to PC, PS5, Xbox Series X and S. This is also a newer game that we're tracking now. It's being developed by Massive Entertainment and published by Ubisoft. So this is from IGN, some information on this from IGN on January 2nd. Star Wars Outlaws, the highly anticipated open-world game from Ubisoft, will be released in late 2024, though Ubisoft and Star Wars owner Disney had previously remained tight-lipped about the release date. A Disney Parks blog post quietly announced the release window, which was previously only confirmed be sometime in 2024. So late 2024. So probably not in the first half of 2024, in the second half. So Frostpunk 2 is coming at us from coming to the PC, PS5, Xbox Series X and S. This is a newer one that we are now tracking. It's being developed by 11-Bit Studio and also published by 11-Bit Studio. So some news on its release from Game 8 on January 17th. Frostpunk 2 is 11-Bit Studio's upcoming follow-up to their hit survival city builder of the same name. Read on to learn about when it will be released and where you can purchase a copy. Frostpunk 2 will be released sometime within the first half of 2024 with no official release date or time currently announced. We'll be sure to update this article with a specific release date, when a specific release date has been revealed. All of the articles that I'm reading from, links in the description down below. Go check that one out. Tommy Boy is probably going to play that and help me review it. Then the next one is one that I've been excited for. I'm still excited for, but at the same time, yeah. If you've been following it, there's some stuff. And that game is Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines 2. Coming to PlayStation 5, Xbox One, PlayStation 4, Microsoft Windows, Xbox Series X, and Series S. It is being developed by the Chinese Room. It was previously being developed by Hardsuit Labs, who were the developers of the first Bloodlines game. Okay, so bear with us here. That's one of the issues that some people have cited, that they switched developers. It's being published by Paradox Interactive. Okay, some news on it. So, an extended gameplay trailer was released on January 31st, 2024. Okay, the game is in post-alpha. The length of this trailer is 33 minutes and 13 seconds long. About 15 minutes of that is gameplay, with the remainder being a developer Q&A. There are some controversies around this, being that the gameplay seemed to be, like, they did a lot of combat, and the dialogue isn't exactly what people expected, with it being a dialogue tree rather than more open-ended dialogue like we had in the first game. You have a voiced protagonist, which is weird because it's like, if it's an RPG, so you basically are you, like, it's controversial because are you removing elements, RPG elements, from this game that originated as a tabletop, you know, like tabletop RPG, and now then was made into a really great, awesome CRPG. Like, basically that's what the original game was, a CRPG. It was really good. It was really great, a really great RPG. And now we have a voice protagonist, which makes it more of an action adventure, like a more of an adventure game. And a lot of people are saying that this, even if it, the thing is that even if it's a good game, a lot of people are saying that it's not going to be a true Bloodlines game. What they could have done is made like a Vampires the Masquerade, blah, 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 blah game, whatever. And instead they're going with a more action oriented game. Even like I said, I do think that the gameplay actually does look good. But is it Bloodlines? That's the question. That'll be for everybody to decide when the game comes out. But some information on its release. Now, this is a little bit long, but I think that it's important because we have been anticipating this game for years and years and years. So, from PC Gamer on February 2nd, 2023, Bloodlines 2 is now scheduled to release in fall of 2024. The sequel has had a long, fraught, and confusing development history, originally scheduled for March 2020, before being pushed back to an unspecified time later that year. It eventually delayed into 2021 and then again delayed out of 2021, leaving its status a mystery. We weren't even sure which studio was handling its development. In 2022, Frederick Wester, CEO at Bloodline 2's publisher Paradox Interactive, tweeted that the game is in good hands. In June 2023, we learned that there would be a big September announcement about Bloodlines 2, and the prophecy held true. In September 2023, we finally learned that the Chinese Room has been handling Bloodlines 2 development. The Chinese Room has only given us brief peeks below the coffin lid to see what the reworked sequel will actually play like until now. In this 33-minute Bloodlines 2 extended gameplay reveal, we watch as Fire, the player character, and in this demo's case, a Bruja, infiltrates a warehouse to learn more about a mark that's locked away her elder vampire powers. We see some dialogue choices, some vampire combat magic, and some grisly first-person combat punctured by neck-biting finishers. As a first gameplay look, it seems okay. I would hope that a flurry of super speed punches backed up by vampire strength would have a little more impact, but it's hard to say how it actually feels until we've had our hands on it. Okay, so yeah, that's another thing. So you can still, even though you play you're playing an elder vampire, and even though you're playing an elder vampire, you can still customize, and there is a named protagonist who is voiced. You can still customize a little bit, and also give a customization as far as what your clan is. But it seems like they're stripping it of some of the key RPG elements that made the first game so good. So it's but I will say, I watched it, the gameplay itself did look good. I just don't know. Again, I don't know if it's a Bloodlines game. So, even if it is a game set in the Vampire Masquerade universe. All right, so then the next one here. Indiana Jones and the Great Circle coming to PC, Xbox Series X and S. And this is also a new game that we are tracking. Again, anything releasing to Xbox Series X and S, tentatively, because they've talked about, you know, they're giving up their exclusives and sharing those with PlayStation 5, so with the PlayStation. So, it's being developed by Machine Games and published by Bethesda. And then here's some information on its release from Game Rant, February 5th, 2024. A new report suggests Indiana Jones and the Great Circle is aiming to release right before the end of 2024, developed by Machine Games, the Bethesda studio responsible for the rebooted Wolfenstein series. Indiana Jones and the Great Circle appeared at Xbox's recent Developer Direct, where it unveiled its full title, lengthy gameplay footage, and stamped a 2024 release window. According to a new report from The Verge, it would seem that Indiana Jones and the Great Circle is targeting a December 2024 release. Cool? I appreciate that information. I'm a little bit weary. Wolfenstein New Blood, Young Blood, New Blood wasn't so great. Bethesda's been a little bit weird recently. I don't know. We'll see how it goes. But we're going to be watching for it. As more news comes out, we'll let you know. Then we have Unrecord, which we've been tracking for a while. We've already known that there wasn't going to be any huge updates, but this is what we've got. So it's being developed by developer Drama, which is a new developer. This is their first game. They're a small indie team. There is no release date currently, but from the official Unrecord Twitter, also known as X, on January 25th, 2024. We want to explain why we don't provide regular updates. Our development team is working tirelessly on the game, and it's a single player. And as it's a single player adventure, we're cautious about not spoiling the experience prematurely. Furthermore, with the high level of attention our project is receiving, any new features we develop is at risk of being replicated. It's flattering in a way to see elements of our vision being echoed in the industry, even if only in a superficial form. However, we're introducing a lot more of new innovative elements, which is why we've chosen to keep these developments under wraps for now. What we have publicly shown of the game is just a tiny part of what we are doing. Rest assured, the development is progressing smoothly. We're just opting to work more discreetly and focus on the quality of the game, but expect some big reveals this year. We're aware of other games that may try to be similar to us, but we're focused on our unique vision and not in a race with others. Our silence doesn't mean inaction. Rather, we're diligently working to bring something truly special to you. We can't wait to share it with you when it's ready. Unrecord has not been released yet and is still under active development. There's no beta or early access available at this stage. Please be aware, any claims to the contrary are likely scams, viruses, or simply ripoffs. This is important. Stay vigilant and safe. Remember, our goal isn't to rush the game for quick profit. Thank you for your patience. Also, we've climbed to number 12 on Steam's most wishlist games list with nearly 1.2 million wishlists. Your enthusiasm is overwhelming. Thank you. We're excited about the future and believe you will be too. So that's really good to hear. Even though, you know, it's an indie developer, we don't have a release date or any prospects of a release date. I believe that at one point it was speculated maybe 2025, maybe 2026, but we don't know. They haven't said. And yes, it's not released. There's no early access, no beta. Don't fall for any scams that tell you. So, and if we hear anything, we will let you guys know. All right, the last one that we have is something we've been tracking for a long time. Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time Remake. PC, PlayStation 4, and Xbox, being developed by Ubisoft and also published by Ubisoft. Currently, it is delayed indefinitely, but we do have some information from IGN on its release from November 21st. Ubisoft's troubled Prince of Persia, The Sands of Time Remake has received a positive update. Publisher shared the news on Twitter, formerly X, This is a typo from them, because I just copy and paste these articles. The publisher shared the news on Twitter, formerly X. It means shared the news on X, formerly Twitter, to help celebrate the 20-year anniversary of the original game's launch. It's a brief and somewhat vague update, but it's at least a sign that the team at Ubisoft Montreal is moving in the right direction. As you know, the passionate team, and this is from Ubisoft here we go. As you know, the passionate team at Ubisoft Montreal is reimagining this legendary story, the update says, and we are glad to announce today that the project has passed an important internal milestone and development is progressing. That's ending the quote from Ubisoft. It's not clear, this is from IGN again, it's not clear what exactly this important internal milestone is. Still, considering the Prince of Persia remake has been engulfed by less than stellar news since its 2020 reveal, it's nice to receive a positive update. That is true. I loved the original game. Can't wait for the remake. It really, really was good. I hope that it is good when it finally does come out. So, listen, guys. Let me just check and make sure that I don't have anything else in my notes. Yeah. That is our kind of wrap up for you guys of 2023, the last quarter, and also what we are going to be doing moving forward into 2024. Please, guys, consider supporting us in any way that you can. Go get some merch. Got the merch. I love the werewolf shirt. I really do. The werewolf really does. I mean, you guys can't really see the best, but it really, really actually is pretty good. So that is all I have for you guys. I do know that the video is extra long. So if you made it this far, thank you so much for watching. Like I said just a second ago, support us any way that you can. We have channel memberships. Help by sharing the videos because we need to hit those watch time hours so that we can get consistent revenue from ads. That would be great. And buy some merch. Check out the Twitch. Check out the blog is on hold right now, but check out the Patreon. Possibly think about supporting us on Patreon. The bigger that we get and the more that we, you know, the bigger that we get and the more support that we get, the more and the better and the bigger things that we can do. I really love you guys. I do. You guys are awesome. The reason that I am able to do the things that I do is because people want to listen to me, you know, talk about video games and movies. And you guys are those people. So thank you, thank you, thank you for all of your support. I do just want to thank you for sticking with us over the years especially, and say God bless you all, and have a good day. Don't forget to check me out on Twitch and join the Discord where you can voice chat with me while I live stream and you won't be recorded or anything on YouTube and Twitch, so that's pretty cool. You can also find me on Facebook and Instagram. If you like to read, you can see my after action reports on my blog. And if you are interested, you can get some merch from my Spring store. The links for everything are in the description below. We'll be right back.